Next, then the person who will pay the tribute is CM Naim. Requires no introduction for this crowd. He is one of North America's top scholars of Urdu language and literature. He's the professor emeritus at the Department of South Asian Language and Civilizations at the University of Chicago. Beside a number of works on history, literature, and politics in modern and pre-modern Muslim South Asia, he founded and edited two academic journals in the United States, Journal of South Asian Literature, which was from 1963 to 1978, and the Annual of Urdu Studies, 1981 to 1991. And so, Naim Sahab, Aya? Aage.
Pardon me if I take a sip. Thank you very much for inviting me. I'm really grateful for the invitation. And I should mention that the last time I was in Madison was also linked to Professor Memon. It was a joyous event organized by Professor Joe Elder. It was really a true celebration of Memon's work. It was an international event. People had come from other countries. I remember there was a French scholar. I think there was a person from Turkey. So it's really very gratifying for me to be invited here today. Thank you. I will read some of it. Basically, I will try to speak, but that's how I manage things now. I met Memon Sahab for the first time late in 1967 in Los Angeles. Professor von Grunebaum at UCLA needed an Urdu wala to come and give a language test to one of the Pakistani graduate students there. And somebody told him about me, and I got invited. So I went. After I was done with the task, Professor von Grunebaum handed me over to a very elegantly dressed young man who was the other Pakistani student at UCLA. And this gentleman, the first thing that struck me very much, because I lack in that quality, was that this gentleman spoke with, in a very careful, precise manner. Every word was very deliberately chosen and spoken. So that impressed me a great deal, and of course, he was very elegantly dressed. That too was a different impressive thing important for me, coming from very grungy Chicago. And I was, of course, in awe of the fact that he knew Arabic and was studying the works of Ibn Taymiyyah. But soon I discovered that the man was not all bad, he was all good. that he was honest to goodness Urdu wala, because in fact, his knowledge of contemporary Urdu literature and Urdu criticism was far beyond any that I could have aspired for. And I was just so delighted, and I think both of us were delighted, finding another Urdu wala in 1967 in America, but there were not that many around. As instructed by Professor von Grunebaum, Memon Sahab showed me around the campus and then took me to his apartment for dinner, where I met Nakako-san, who immediately won me over by the warmth and sincerity of her welcome. Now, I must add this, Nakako-san. Of all the people I have met, she is, I would say, extraordinarily well-read person that I have met. You have no idea how, what a voracious reader she is, and how much, what a wide range of her interests are. It's just mind-boggling. So that was another great discovery with these two persons, just marvelously well-read, well-informed, and whereas Memon Sahab could be diffident in some matters, whereas if there was any intellectual issue involved, then Nakako-san was very firm and would flatly told you very politely that you were mistaken, as he knew. So we got along very well. We had some hard times too, because we also had strong opinions on some issues. So there were some times of tension between us. But both of us observed a kind of old-fashioned wazadari. I mean, I remember one year, Nakako-san, you may not, but I do, that whenever I would come to the annual conference here, I always stayed with Memon Sahab. That went without saying. And so one year, when there was a great deal of tension between us, I came to medicine. I came and stayed in their house. Memon and Saab and I didn't talk much outside of the house. We behaved very well inside the house, but that's how it went. So that's how it was. There was one thing that I'm sure, and I sometimes felt that Memon Saab was disappointed in me, that I was not an Aligarian. He was born and raised in Aligarh, and Aligarh was very important to him. He may not say it right away, but whenever if the subject came around, he could be. But I could not share with him any memory of Shamshad Building or Manto Circle or SS East or SS West and so forth. So that sort of I'm sure he was disappointed about that. He remained very devoted to Aligarh and emotionally. Though I must say that a recent article by an old friend of his, Nasir Baghdadi, who lives in Toronto now and is very well-known, respected author, fiction writer and literary critic and editor. He wrote a remembrance of Memon Sahab, a very close friend of his. I saw it in Imroz, where he brings up the issue of the tension between him and his father, the great scholar Abdul Aziz Memon. So I'm sure leaving Aligarh, where he would have been much more under the influence or under the gaze of his father, moving to Karachi really made him blossom, because he just, when I met him, he had already published stories, he had already published criticism, and he was on his speaking terms with a great many of the coming new authors, and it was just a very amazing find for me. But going back to that day in LA in 67, I must share another memory. of that day with you. Something that I observed at dinner that evening at his place. Memon Sahab had a rule that his wife should never cook for his friends. So whenever you went to his house, he cooked the meal. And so we had a delicious desi meal with him. And at the end, he offered us for dessert fresh peaches. Californian peaches, wonderful. But it was not a simple offering. They had been ripened at home first properly, I was told, in a brown bag. Then put in the fridge earlier during the day. Now they were taken out from the fridge, dipped for a brief moment, precise brief moment, in hot water. I think it was boiling water, I'm not sure, to loosen the skin. Then they were properly peeled, and then with a nice sharp knife, they were cut into thin, precise slices. Only then was I able to get my hands on them. That whole thing, that whole idea of ripening a peach, putting it in the refrigerator for a certain time, and taking it out and dipping into hot water for the poor thing to loosen up its skin, and then to have it sliced into precise slices and all these things. I mean, I just watched it and it stuck in my mind. And it is that meticulousness of an act, in an act, that I think was an inseparable part of Memon Sahab's personality. He was a meticulous person in whatever undertaking, you know, he was involved in any activity he undertook and he thought was serious and important. I would say one very fine example, visible example, is the physical look of the journal, Annual of Urdu Studies. I mean, when I started it, you look at it and it's the most amateurish thing you can imagine. But his first issue, from the first issue, you saw that it was a proper, professionally done object. And his effort to be professional in the best sense of that word, I think, was also present in his translation work. I don't know of very many translators who of Urdu, translators of Urdu work, who worried over you know, the words of the author so much, making an effort to not only use dictionaries and ask friends about it, but also approaching the author and discussing with the author about why this particular word is used and whether it is his intentions are properly indicated by the English word chosen by the translator. And I used to see my friend Nair Masood on my visits in Lucknow, and he would often remark on that fact. And he was very impressed by the fact that he would get these queries from Memon Sahab about his language, because Nair Masood himself was a very careful writer. He knew exactly why a particular word was put there by him. And so when I heard from him, I had to tell him that, yes, that comes as no surprise to me. And of course, we know that it is only thanks to Memon Sahab's excellent, remarkable translation of Nayyar Masood that Nayyar Masood is now available to those who read French and Spanish. I would also like to emphasize another aspect of how much time. Please drag me, stop me.
If you can just finish soon, that would be great.
But no, because I have something important to say.
Then please take your time.
I don't want to miss out.
No, then please take your time.
Oh, okay. He was a most avid reader of fiction in both English and Urdu, and tremendously interested in world literature. He was keenly interested in anything new and contemporary in fiction. And that was not, as a result of it, he was also constantly discovering new authors, coming authors in Urdu. Hasan Manzar, I came to know of Hasan Manzar only thanks to Memon Sahab. At that time, Hasan Manzar had published only one volume of his amazing stories and on some miserable looking paper and at his own expenditure. So, and similarly, Anwar Sajjad and Balraj Mehendra, they appeared in English at the time when they were just barely getting known in Urdu. Similarly, in 2010, when he put together a selection of short stories for Words Without Borders of Indian Muslim, Indian Urdu writers, he was able to find Salam bin Razak and Anwar Khan and Sajid Rashid and others and include them and put them into English for a much wider audience. And of course, when Zakia Mashhadi surprised everybody, suddenly appearing out of nowhere and with these amazing, wonderful stories, very soon, Memon Sahab put together a whole book of her stories in English. I don't want to say anything about his fiction in Urdu, but I must add here that his translations in Urdu are extensive and really will be read for quite some time as younger authors. He favored Milan Kundera, Orhan Pamuk, Marquez, and quite a few other people. And I think he has, I would say at least, 1,000 pages or maybe more in two big fat volumes of these translations. When he undertook anything that interested him, he really went after it. I was so surprised just glancing through the issues of the annual. I found that he had put together a progressive miscellany. You know, he was not particularly interested in progressive writers. And so he was thumbing his nose, I think, when he put together this progressive miscellany, because it includes Muhammad Hassan Askari, Zaheer Kashmiri, Saadat Hassan Manto, and Aziz Ahmed. And out of the 10 items that he included, 11 items, 10 were translated by him. I mean, it's just amazing amount of work. Now I want to say the two important things. The first is that he put together his first work at University of Wisconsin. I think he moved here in 1970. Very soon after that, he organized the first ever conference on Urdu literature in America. And maybe there had not been an Urdu conference in India of that nature, I don't know. But at least in America, that was the first conference of devoted to Urdu literature. And the proceedings were published in, edited and published by him in a book called Studies in the Urdu Ghazal and Prose Fiction. I feel that somebody ought to edit that book again and maybe collect some of the other translations that he did related to Urdu Ghazal. For example, I remember he translated some very good things for me when I requested him on Ghazal that we published in AUS. It would be wonderful if that book is reissued, at least the papers on Urdu, on the Ghazal itself. What was very interesting that even at that stage, he somehow managed to bring Shamsur Rahman Farooqi from India and Gilani Kamran from Lahore. And both of them were very far apart in their perspective on the true nature of classical Urdu or the true heritage of the classical. And so though they presented their ideas, and those papers are there in that volume, and there were very good discussions at that time. So I think that is valuable book to recover. The second thing is extremely important. We have to protect what he has left behind. He managed very extensive correspondence with people. And knowing how meticulous he was, I'm sure that there are numbered folders with names, with all the letters properly dated there. Some cases probably also copies of his own letter when Xeroxing became possible. He was constantly corresponding with people. He was receiving requests, letters from authors. And though that correspondence, I think, must be preserved, must be protected, and at least protected for now for future scholars to look at and to work on. There are also any number of books that authors sent him. They had to be protected. Nagako-san, you have rooms full of stuff that you probably want to get rid of. Well, good. We will take care of it, I am sure. Sooner than later, we assure you. And there are people who are very keenly interested in preserving whatever we can of our friend, colleague. Thank you.
Zahra Sabri. I'm a PhD student in Mughal history and Indo-Muslim literatures at the Institute of Islamic Studies at McGill University. I had the honor and pleasure of Dr. Maimon's friendship for 4 years before he died. It was in fact here at the Madison Conference one evening that I met him in 2014. A friend from Karachi, Akbar Zaidi, ran into him and invited me to join them, and we all just seemed to hit it off. We must have talked for 6 or 7 hours straight that night. We did not want to part. It was almost morning before the mehfil broke up in the Concourse Hotel lobby. And then he sent us the kindest email, saying our meeting seemed to have occurred in a dream. He shared the following share. Azok, kisi hamdame derina ka milna, behtar hai mulaqate masiha o khizar se. And so began a deep association. I must have met him only once more in Karachi after that, but we liked to exchange long newsy emails, and several times a year, we would talk on Skype or on the phone. Whenever he spoke of a word or concept which interested him, he would be overcome with tremendous enthusiasm, and that excitement would be infectious. And I really treasured those moments. I had been reading his translation since a long time, but the first time I ever saw him, it was at an Urdu conference in Karachi, notorious for its mismanagement and inefficacy. It seemed to be a point of pride for scholars to sit on stage, regardless of whether or not they had something to present. And the organizers would make a great show of spotting a famous face in the audience and inviting them to sit on stage. His name was also called, but he refused to get on stage. And I remember thinking then that this person is different from the run-of-the-mill Urdu scholars. He doesn't go in for such hollow gestures. Later on, a stranger in the crowd told me that this is Umar Memon, and that he had worked for Urdu tirelessly and unselfishly without any expectation of financial profit or personal accolades. The word he used was belos, and to this day, especially since coming to know him, belos is a word which always makes me think of Memon Saab. His face was not well known in Pakistan, but his translations into Urdu were well recognized and benefited many. He had translated over a dozen novels of non-Western writers into Urdu, and also rendered into Urdu writings on Sufi metaphysics, science and medieval Islamic societies, and literary criticism. His politics was staunchly anti-imperialist and anti-Orientalist, and that was the impulse behind much of the work that he selected for translation, because he wanted Westerners to understand Muslims through a broader social and literary lens, and for Muslims to be able to access revised understanding of their own civilization's history. I remember him explaining his impulses for focusing on translation and other work in one of his emails to me. I'm concerned and unhappy about the contemporary degeneration of Urdu and try to do what I can to give it an uplift in my own work, fully conscious that my ability to write good Urdu is declining by the day. I've come to realize over the years that too much extraneous concern about issues and public debates about them eventually becomes an end in itself and kills, quite imperceptibly though, the least desire to do something about changing the situation in practical terms. At some point, gathering knowledge, knowing the last tiniest detail about something should come to a stop, and the real task of changing the situation should start. The superhuman amount of energy and discipline one individual needed to produce such a vast quantity of translations would have made his project unique and impressive enough, but the sheer quality of the translations meant that awe is too small a word for what I feel when I read them. Having done just a little bit of translation work professionally myself, I feel I'm reading something of a quality which is very difficult to aspire to. His triumph in translation, I feel, is that he manages to retain much of the vivacity and deft force of a writer's original words. He follows the writer closely, then bravely abandons him, and often comes up with a superb sentence which captures what the writer had said in a totally different but apt way. Different people saw very different facets of his personality. Some of his obituaries described him as an intensely private person. This really surprised me and a number of his other friends, for we had found him to be very different. In fact, he was very open about himself, his views, his interests, and his family life. He really enjoyed spending time with his toddler grandsons and would often share photos. "You will like my wife," he informed me a couple of times. So I was like, all right, we'll see. But it was true. Unfortunately, somehow things worked out in such a way that our first meeting only took place after his death, when I visited her to pay my condolences. And upon meeting her, I immediately realized what he meant. That same sincerity, openness, courtesy, and warmth that I had experienced from him, he had gauged the matter correctly. Every act of translation is also an act of self-discovery, he would say. Till the last, even when he knew he had mere months left to live, he went on working as before, translating, writing, publishing, inviting you to share interesting articles on Muslim Spain with him. And I know that I speak for a number of his friends when I say that with his passing, we felt as if a window had shut in our lives forever. A scenic view had disappeared, a way of experiencing the world had ended, except where it remains in the copious works he has left us. Such is the life of a true scholar. Muhammad Umar Memon, gone now these 16 months with the rich and rare world he carried within him. bhale na astilima. Mem Saab dedicated his life to introducing Urdu writers to global audiences and writers from around the world to Urdu readers. In honor of this tradition, it's wonderful that AIPS has been able to bring Mr. Ali Akbar Natiq from Pakistan to present his work to us here at Madison and to educate us about fresh new trends in Urdu writing. Ali Akbar Natiq is a new voice in Urdu prose and poetry. In less than a decade since his emergence on the scene, he has taken the literary world by storm. A prolific writer, he has published several books of poetry and fiction within a very short period of time. With truly dramatic speed, his work has garnered tremendous attention and appreciation from literary critics in far-flung parts of the world, with the renowned Urdu critic Shamsur-Rehman Farooqi likening his poetic style to Mirajis and describing his work as bringing Punjab alive in Urdu literature in a way which no other Urdu writer has managed to do so far, despite the fact that any number of prominent Urdu writers have emerged from that region over the past 100 years. Born in Ukhara in Punjab, Pakistan in 1973, Ali Akbar Natiq worked for several years as a mason specializing in mosque construction in his native district, completing his formal education privately. Later, he was associated in various teaching and administrative capacities with a number of educational institutions in Islamabad and Lahore. He gained his bachelor's degree from Bahauddin Zakaria University in 1998 and his MPhil in Urdu literature from Minhaj University, Lahore last year. He has published several collections of Urdu poetry, Beyaqeen Bastiyon Mein, Yaqut Ke Barq, Sur Mandal Ka Raja, and Sabz Bastiyon Ke Ghazal. Two collections of short stories, Qaim Deen, translated into English as What Will You Give for This Beauty, and Shah Muhammad Katanga, a novel, and also a novel, Nolakhi Koti, a work of criticism on Iqbal's poetry, Hayat-e-Sher, and a number of other works. His writings have been translated into English, Hindi, Pashto, and German, and he has also written in a number of genres in Punjabi. Since we are paying tribute to one of Urdu's famous translators this evening, before I request Mr. Natiq to present his Urdu verse to us, I would like to take the opportunity to recite for everybody the English translation of a famous Urdu poem of Mr. Natiq's. It is a poem which he wrote on a cement bag many years ago while working at a construction site. Name and pedigree. You who ask my name and pedigree, listen. The old inscriptions on my ancestors' graves, whose writing proclaims the afflictions of passing days, whose worn-out stones are damp-ridden, salt-ridden, and which remain fated to suffer the misfortunes of the age. Generation to generation, without exception, those ancestors of mine, whose will was no different from their master's desires. While alive, when did they ever feature among the living? And upon death, their body was merely a burden. Who knew neither the school nor the battlefield, who were neither oppressors nor did they confront an oppressor, who neither sought the throne nor experienced the dungeon. You who ask my name and pedigree, listen. I am the living legacy of such gratuitous slaves. Thank you.
Memon sahab ko main tribute kya pesh karunga jahan pe CM Naim sahab ne unka taaruf karwa diya. Main bas itna kahunga ki unhone apne aakhri जनत में मेरा एक अफसाना छापा था और उसके बाद वो जिंदा नहीं रहे. मैं इसकी माफ चाहता हूँ उनसे और उनके हक में जाए शायद करता हूँ. मैं अपनी नज़्म पेश करता हूँ. कुछ दिन से मेरा नाम मुझे याद नहीं है. कुछ रोज हुए मैंने धुआं वो ऐ मेरा नाम नसब पूछने वाले सुन ले. میرے اجداد کی قبروں کے پرانے قطبے اے میرا نام و نسب پوچھنے والے سن لے. میرے اجداد کی قبروں کے پرانے قطبے جن کی تحریر مہو سال کے فتنوں کی نقیب, جن کی بہت سیدھا سلیں سیم زدہ شور زدہ اور آسیب زمانے کے رہے جن کا نصیب. پوشت در پوشت بلا فصل وہ اجداد میرے, اپنے آقاؤں کی منشا تھی مشیت ان کی. گر وہ زندہ تھے تو زندوں میں وہ شامل کب تھے, اور مرنے پہ فقط بوجھ تھی میت ان کی. جن کو مکتب سے لگاؤ تھا نہ مقتل کی خبر, جو نہ ظالم تھے نہ ظالم کے مقابل آئے. جن کی مسند پہ نظر تھی نہ ہی زندان کا سفر. اے میرا نام و نسب پوچھنے والے سن لے. ایسے بے دام غلاموں کی نشانی میں ایک نظم ہے ریشم بننا کھیل نہیں ہم دھرتی کے پہلے کیڑے ہم دھرتی کا پہلا ماس ہم دھرتی کے پہلے کیڑے ہم دھرتی کا پہلا ماس دل کے لہو سے سانس ملا کر سچا نور بناتے ہیں اپنا آپ ہی کھاتے ہیں اور ریشم بنتے جاتے ہیں خواب نگر کی خاموشی اور تنہائی میں پلتے ہیں صاف مصفہ اجلا ریشم تاریکی میں بنتے ہیں کس نے سمجھا کیسے بنے ہیں چاندی کی کرنوں کے تار کنج جگر سے کھینچ کے لاتے ہیں ہم نور کے ذروں کو شرم آتے ہیں دیکھ کے جن کو نیل گگن کے تارے بھی ہم کو خبر ہے ان کاموں میں جان کا زیاں ہو جاتا ہے لیکن فطرت کی مجبوری ہم ریشم کے کیڑوں کی سچا ریشم بنتے ہیں اور تار لپٹتے جاتے ہیں آخر گھٹ کر مر جاتے ہیں ریشم کی دیواروں میں کوئی ریشم بن کر دیکھے ریشم بننا کھیل نہیں ایک نظم ہے ہجوم گریا ہمیں بھی رولے ہجوم گریا کہ پھر نہ آئیں گے غم کے موسم ہمیں بھی رولے ہجوم گریا کہ پھر نہ آئیں گے غم کے موسم ہمیں بھی رولے کہ ہم وہی ہیں جو آفتابوں کی بستیوں سے سراغ لائے تھے ان سویروں کا جن کو شبنم کے پہلے قطروں نے غسل بخشا سفید رنگوں سے نور مانی نکال لیتے تھے اور چاندی اجالتے تھے شفق پہ ٹھہرے سنہرے بادل پہ زرد سونے کو ڈھالتے تھے خنک ہواؤں میں خوشبوؤں کو ملا کے ان کو اڑانے والے صبا کی پرتوں پہ شعر لکھ کر عدم کی شکلیں بنانے والے دماغ رکھتے تھے لفظ و معنی کا اور دستے ہنر کے مالک وقار نور چراغ ہم تھے ہمیں بھی رولے ہجوم گریا ہمیں بھی رولے کہ ہم وہی ہیں جو تیز آندھی میں صاف چہروں کو دیکھ لیتے تھے اور سانسوں کو بھانپتے تھے فلک نشینوں سے گفتگویں تھیں اور پریوں سے کھیلتے تھے کریم لوگوں کی صحبتوں میں کشادہ کنویں سخا کو دیکھا کبھی نہ روکا تھا ہم کو سورج کے چوبداروں نے قصر بیضہ کے داخلے سے وہی تو ہم ہیں وہی تو ہم ہیں جو لٹ چکے ہیں حفیظ راہوں میں لٹنے والے اسی فلک کی سیاہ زمین پر جہاں پہ لرزاں ہیں شور نالا سے عادلوں کی سنہری کڑیاں ہمیں بھی رولے کہ ان دنوں میں ہماری پشتوں پہ بار ہوتا ہے زخم تازہ کے سرخ پھولوں کا اور گردن میں سرد آہن کی کوہنا لڑیاں ہماری ضد میں سفید ناخن قلم بنانے میں دست قاتل کا ساتھ دیتے ہیں اور نیزے اچھالتے ہیں ہماری ضد میں ہی ملک و ملکوں کے شہریاروں نے عہد باندھے یہی کہ ہم کو دھوئیں سے باندھیں اور اب دھوئیں سے بندے ہوئے ہیں سو ہم پہ رونے کے نوحہ کرنے کے دن یہی ہیں ہجوم گریا کہ مستعد ہیں ہمارے ماتم میں گہرے سایوں کی سرد شامیں خزاں رسیدہ طویل شامیں ہمیں بھی رو لے ہجوم گریا کہ پھر نہ آئیں گے غم کے موسم دو نظمیں اور ہیں اگر ٹائم
کم ہے تو جو لسٹ تھی وہی ہم پڑھ لیں
کچھ دن سے میرا نام مجھے یاد نہیں ہے کچھ روز ہوئے میں نے دھواں پھیلتے دیکھا کچھ دن سے میرا نام مجھے یاد نہیں ہے کچھ روز ہوئے میں نے دھواں پھیلتے دیکھا اب رقص کی گردش میں بکھر جاؤں میں شاید تم مجھ کو پری خانے سے آواز نہ دینا سو بار کرے ابر میرے نام پہ گریا اس بار میرا درد اسے راہ نہ دے گا سو بار مجھے شمس و قمر ڈھونڈنے نکلیں اس بار نشاں میرا کسی خواب میں ہوگا شاید مجھے افلاک سے آواز بھی آئے उस वक्त मेरा नाम मुझे याद ना होगा, नाकाम पलट जाएगी आवाज वो आखिर, और लोग कहेंगे कि मुझे मौत ना आई, मैं मौत से बच जाऊंगा, पर देख मेरे दोस्त तुम मुझको परी खाने से आवाज ना देना। अब एक शिया औरतों का गीत है, आप जानते हैं कि पाकिस्तान में शिया किलिंग का क्या है और वो उसके, तो मैंने शिया माओं का दुख जो कि उनके बेटे, उसमें एक नसरी नज्म है और इसके बाद में एक सफीरे लैला का एक बंद सुनाऊंगा। और ये शिया औरतों का गीत, हमारी कोख बांझ नहीं है ना हमारी छातियां रिज्क देने में बुखल करती हैं, हम पाक आयतों की तलावत और सीगों के विर्द के दौरान मनकूहा होने वाली औरतें हैं, नेक मुबाशरत में हलाल ज़ादे जनती हैं, फिर उन्हें नर्म खाल हरनों की तरह गोद में छुपाती हैं और ताहिर दूध का रिज्क देकर पालती हैं, हम वो हैं जिन्हें सोज और गिरिया के लहन नहीं भूलते, गिरिया और सलाम की लोरियों से अपने बच्चों को सुलाती हैं, उन्हें दरूद और सलात की आवाज़ों का सुनने वाला और सुनाने वाला बनाती हैं, हमें अपने जने हुओं की गिनती नहीं भूलती, ना हम उन्हें बारूद के कुर्ते पहनने देती हैं, ना वो वर्गलाए जाने वालों में शुमार किए जा सकते हैं, मगर अफसोस हाय अफसोस, हमारे हलाल जादों को जवान होते ही भेड़िए खा जाते हैं, वो भेड़िए जिन्हें उनकी माएँ जन कर भूल जाती हैं, वो माएँ उन्हें जन कर ऐसे फेंक देती हैं जैसे उन पर कोई मेहनत न खर्च हुई हो, या उन्हें शिकमों की बजाय आग की धोंकनी से निकाला गया हो, वो भेड़िए खा जाते हैं हमारे इस कायनात के अजीज तरीन बेटों को, और हम माएँ अपने अपने यूसुफ की माएँ फकत उनके खून आलूद कुर्ते आंखों और सीनों से लगाए अंधे याकूब का गिरिया में हाथ बटाती हैं, ये गिरिया हमारी तमाम उम्र की पूंजी है, जैनब के शुक्रिया के साथ हमारा गिरिया हुसैन के लिए है, मगर कभी कभी अपने यूसुफों पर भी रोने को जी चाहता है, हम शिया औरतें वो याकूब हैं जिनके कई कई यूसुफों को भेड़िए खा गए और वो याकूब के बेटे की तरह वापस नहीं आए, ना हमारी आंखें वापस आती हैं, ऐ हमारी खाली गोदियां देखने वालों, हमारी कोख बांझ नहीं थी ना हमारी छातियां रिज्क देने में बुखल करती थी। आखिरी नज़्म आपको सुनाकर इजाज़त चाहूंगा। सफीरे लाला इसके चार बंद है, मैं एक यहां सुनाऊंगा और इजाज़त चाहूंगा। सफीर लैला यही खंडर हैं जहां से आगाज दास्तां है, सफीर लैला यही खंडर हैं जहां से आगाज दास्तां है, जरा सा बैठो तो मैं सुनाऊं फसीले करिया के सुर्ख पत्थर और इन पे अजदर निशान बुर्जें गवाह करिया की अदमतों की, चहार जानब नखील तूबा और इनमें बहते फरावा चश्मे, बुलंद पेड़ों के ठंडे साए थे, शाख ज़ैतून इसी जगह थी, यही सुतू थे जो देखते हो पड़े हैं मुर्दा गिदों के माने, उठाए रखते थे इनके शाने अजीम कसरों की संगी सकफें, यही वो दर है सफीर लैला की जिनके तख्ते उड़ा दिए हैं दिनों की आवारा सरसरों ने, यही से गुजरी थी सुर्ख ऊंटों की वो किदारें कि उनकी पुश्ते सनूबरों के सफेद पालान लेके चलती, उठाए फिरती जवान परियों की महमलों को, ये सहने करिया है इन जगहों पर घनी खजूरों की सब्ज शाखें फलक से ताजा फलों के खोशे चुरा के भरती थी पहलुओं में, सफेद पानी के सौ कुएं यूं भरे हुए थे कि चौड़ी मशकों को हाथ भर की ही रस्सियां थी, मुजाफ करिया में सब्जा गाहें और इनमें चरती थी फरमा भेड़े, शुमाल करिया में नील गायें मीनारे मस्जिद से देखते थे परे हजारों कबूतरों के, फसील करिया से गुम्बदों तक پروں کو زوروں سے پھڑ پھڑاتے تھے اور سہنوں میں دوڑتے تھے. یہی تھا سب کچھ صفیر لیلا, اسی جگہ پر جہاں ببولوں کے خار پھرتے ہیں چوہیوں کی سواریوں پر, جہاں پرندوں کے ہول آتے ہیں راکھ اڑتی ہے ہڈیوں کی. یہی وہ وحشت سرا ہے جس میں دلوں کی آنکھیں لرز رہی ہیں. صفیر لیلا تم آج آئے ہو تو بتاؤں, تیرے مسافر یہاں سے نکلے افق کی پربت سے اس طرف کو, وہ ایسے نکلے کہ پھر نہ آئے. ہزار کوہنا دعائیں گرچے بزرگ ہونٹوں سے اٹھ کے بامے فلک پہ پہنچی مگر نہ آئے. اور اب یہاں پر نہ کوئی موسم, نہ بادلوں کے شفیق سائے, نہ سورجوں کے سفید پرتو, فقط سزائیں ہیں اونگ بھرتی کریہ چہروں کی دیویاں ہیں. صفیر لیلا یہاں جو دن ہیں وہ دن نہیں ہیں, یہاں کی راتیں ہیں بے ستارہ, سحر میں کوئی نمی نہیں. بہت شکریہ آپ کا, یہ نظم جنت ضیاء کا نتیجہ ہے.
بہت شکریہ.
تھینک یو سو مچ ناطق صاحب, دیٹ واز جسٹ ونڈرفل, اینڈ زارا یو ڈیڈ اے بیوٹیفل جاب, تھینک یو سو مچ. ایبسولیٹلی I think what Naim Saab said, we must keep that foremost in our mind, that we need to preserve his legacy and his papers and whatever AIPS can do to facilitate that, that, you know, we would be happy to do that. And again, welcome, and yeah, thank you. This was really wonderful. So now we move to the next section of the program. And so first we have now a joyful announcement, and that is to announce our 2019 AIPS Book Prize Award winner. This is not a surprise because we have already sort of issued a public statement, so it's not like the Oscar moment where I'm just opening the envelope. But the wonderful thing is that the author is here, and we're going to have let me just read what the committee wrote, so that so each year the AIPS seeks submission of books published within the last 3 years for its annual book prize. And AIPS is pleased to announce the winner of 2019 book prize as Dr. Ammara Maqsood for her book titled The New Pakistani Middle Class. So congratulations. Dr. Maqsood's book was chosen for its relevance to Pakistan studies, as well as the impressive way it weaves together ideas of religion, religious identity, piety, consumption, and modernity into an enjoyable and accessible narrative. Maqsood tells a story about life in contemporary middle-class Lahore that is at once local and global. And so I'm very pleased, and this is the book. She already has the book, so I'm not giving her the book.
Congratulations.
Yes. And so we have one more announcement, and that is Akbar, where are you? So that one I'm going to let Akbar take over.
We begin in the name of Ghalib. Sajalwa rubaru hai jo mizga uthaiye, taqat kahan ke deed ka ehsaan uthaiye. Many of us walk in the sort of on the roads that have been lit by the legacy of Memon Saab. I am here representing the editorial board of our new journal, the Journal of Urdu Studies. With me are Pasha Muhammad Khan, Gregory Max Bruce. Two colleagues who are missing are Tahira Naqvi and Jennifer Dubois. We are very, very happy to launch the first issue of the Journal of Urdu Studies, published by Braille. The cover is designed by Daisy Rockwell, again a dear friend who is unable to be with us today. A lot of work has gone into it, and without the support of each and every one of you, this would not have been possible. The number of submissions we received was just stunning, and I'm very grateful to all of you who have supported us. There are some people who deserve to be mentioned more than once, and my friend, colleague, Max Bruce, who has really dedicated his life to the journey. Great. And the purpose, the sort of spirit behind the journal is very simple. We want to foster conversations among disciplines, among regions, and believe it or not, in our first issue, we have 4 generations of Urdu scholars. Wow. So that's quite something. Beginning with Professor Naim, who has written the first article. So it's my honor to present the first copy to Naim Sahib. The foundation of several journals, and our field would not be where it is without his support, love, and encouragement. Our deadline for the next issue is February 15, so please send me your submissions. It's a peer-reviewed journal, so you don't have to, when you're applying for jobs or promotion, you don't have to worry, you know, how to sort of refer to it. It really is a peer-reviewed journal, and so, you know, so here we go. And again, thank you, everybody. And
we need to give Akbar Saab a round of applause.
Tremendous.
We have some display copies here, so if you want to come in, unfortunately, I can't give them out right now, but.